Yes, good morning everyone. So we will start with our today's session. So before we start with our today's session, in brief, we will discuss what we had discussed yesterday. Yesterday, because of some network issue, we could not conduct the complete lecture. In between, I think one or two times, I tried to start the discussion, but because of network issue, we could not complete that. So before moving on to today's topic of the rights of minority shareholders or small shareholders, as well as how the rights of small shareholders are protected. Before that, we will just discuss in brief what we had discussed yesterday. Yesterday, we had discussed the stakeholders of in corporate governance. One of the stakeholders that we haven't discussed so far, we had discussed yesterday, was the government. Under that, we had discussed that government, with the help of various machineries, controls or monitors the functioning of the companies which are listed. So that we had discussed, for that the government has number of machineries. One of the major machinery is called as SEBI, which is empowered with various rights and authorities to monitor or to check whether all the rules or the norms which are mentioned, particularly in the Companies Act 2013, are being followed by the companies. The next major functionary is the stock exchange. They are again empowered with various authorities. One of the authority is that they can ask for any related information from the company. And it is compulsory on the part of company to provide that related information to stock exchange in due time. That means that if it is expected that this information should be shared in, say, 2 days or 3 days, so that should be followed by a particular company. To make the things more convenient and more easier for the stock exchange as well as for the company, because the law says that in case the company defaults in providing the required information in time, at that particular time, the company may face a penalty under Companies Act 2013. To make the things smooth, there is a provision that all the listed companies should appoint a special officer who will be called as compliance officer. Now, this compliance officer's name, then his number, his designation, his address, his email ID. So all the details of these compliance officers are to be shared with SEBI, as well as are to be shared with stock exchange, so that whenever any information is sought by these government agencies, they know that who is the contact person of that particular company. It should not happen that the government organizations are not aware whom they should contact in case of any information requirement. So whether they should be contacting the managing director or the senior finance manager or the general manager of the organization to remove such type of confusion. The provision is included that every listed company should appoint a compliance officer. Yesterday, we had also discussed about how information related to marketing, market rumors can be sought by the companies. Now, rumors, we all know that rumors are the information which may be correct or may be wrong. They are rumors because they are not connected with strong information or strong backing. That is why they are not considered as authentic information. So it may be true, it may be wrong. So when we were talking about 2 days back, when we were discussing Satyam computer system case, we came to know that there was a fraud and that fraud was brought to notice after 11 years. So there were rumors of this particular fraud that something is happening which is unethical and which is not correct as per law in Satyam company. But at that particular time, there was no provision of such type. So this rumor cannot be authenticated by the company or cannot be checked by the stock exchange or SEBI in time. After that, in 2013, this provision was included in Companies Act. And now the stock exchanges are given the authority that if they hear any such type of rumor of any listed company, they are empowered now that they can contact the compliance officer. They can inform the compliance officer about that rumor which is being spread in the market about that particular company. And they can sought clarification about that rumor from the compliance officer in a short span of time, say in 2 days, 3 days or 7 days. It depends upon the type of rumor to be addressed. So they can ask the information and they can clear that rumor. So there will be no doubt in the minds of public, in the minds of shareholders, in the minds of SEBI or stock exchange. So that we had discussed yesterday. Today we will be taking up the rights and how these rights are protected of small shareholders. We have already discussed the various rights of shareholders, but that discussion was related to the general rights of general shareholders. Now we will be focusing on the minority shareholders or the small shareholders. There are two types of shareholders, majorly we can say. One type is called as majority shareholder, who are having major shares of a particular company. And the other type is called as minority or small shareholders. Now, Companies Act has defined the term small shareholders. So any shareholder, as per Companies Act 2013, any shareholder who is having less than 20,000 rupees value of shares, that shareholder is called as small shareholder or minority shareholder. So very simple, any shareholder who is having shares of a company, but the value of his or her shares is less than 20,000 rupees, then that shareholder will be categorized as minority or small shareholders. Now, why these shareholders need protection from the law? So basically, for two reasons, these shareholders are getting protection from law. First reason is they do not have voting control over the company. And second, they do not have management control over the company. When it comes to voting, as they are having very less shares, their vote doesn't have that much value. When any major decision is to be taken, their votes are ignored because they are into minority. Decisions are based on majority votes. Second thing, that they are deprived or they doesn't have control over the management of the company. Now again, we have discussed how decisions of board of a company is taken. There we had discussed that majority of the decisions are taken by majority. That if 20 is the strength of directors, then whatever decision is backed by majority of director is generally becomes the final decision. So as these small shareholder doesn't have these two rights, government thought that their interests are to be protected. Now, how their interests are protected and what are their rights, that we will be discussing one by one. First right given to the small shareholder is called as right to appoint small shareholder directors. Now, we had discussed the executive director, non-executive director under various types of directors. But here we will be talking about a director who can be appointed by small shareholders or minority shareholders. So the first right which we will be discussing is right to appoint small shareholder director. Now here the Companies Act empowers the minority shareholders to elect an individual as a small shareholder director on the board of a listed company. Now, this shareholder can be appointed by the small shareholder if a proposal of such type is backed by, is approved by at least 1,000 such small shareholders or 10% of the total small shareholders of the company, whichever is lesser. So the condition is also there that a small shareholder director can be appointed by minority shareholders or small shareholders, but the condition is that this proposal of appointing a director for taking care of the small shareholders should be backed by at least 1,000 small shareholders or 10% of the small shareholders, whichever is lesser. So if the proposal is backed by, say, 10% of small shareholders or 1,000, more than 1,000 small shareholders, then it becomes compulsory for a company to include one director who will be called as a small shareholder director. That director will be an independent director. The duration, they have mentioned the durations also, that once appointed, this small shareholder director will remain in office for a period of 3 years. Now, major change here is that earlier we had discussed that independent directors are having a right to get re-elected on the board. They are eligible for re-election. Once their tenure of say 3 years or 5 years or 2 years is over, they are eligible for getting re-elected on that particular position. But that particular right is not given to the small shareholder director. After a period of 3 years, he has to vacate his office of independent director as small shareholder director. He is not eligible for re-nomination or re-election. That is the condition under right to appoint small shareholder director. Also, to make this right of small shareholder full proof, one provision is added under this right, which says that as the small shareholder director is not eligible for re-election, he is also not eligible to be part of the company for a period of next 3 years. That means if in 2020, the small shareholder director is elected as independent director to the board of a company, he is supposed to retire after 3 years. That means he will be retiring at the last of say 2023. Or early of 2024. So once he is retired from his office, for 3 years, he should not be associated with the affairs of the company. Now, this particular provision is added to make the protection of small shareholders more strong. It is trying to curtail on any malpractices which may be done by the company or the majority shareholders of the company. Because we had two days back, we had discussed that when we were discussing Satyam case, that the independent directors were very much experience and they were the topmost experts of the world. But we had discussed that one of the independent director, why he remained silent for this type of misappropriation, the reason for that silence was that he was offered a consultancy project for a amount of say 87 lakhs that we had discussed. So favor was done to an independent director and we can say that his silence was purchased by the company. Now same thing should not happen. Here the company's board should not make a deal with the small shareholder director that okay, do not raise the right or issues or complaints of the small shareholders every now and then. If you keep quiet, after you vacate your position as independent director for small shareholders, after a period of 3 years, we will include you as independent director in our board, or we will associate you with the affairs of the company, or we will financially compensate you after 3 years. To curb these practices, the Company Act clearly lays down that for after vacating the office of small shareholder director, that particular director, nor he is eligible for re-election, neither he can be associated with the company for a period of 3 years. So that is the related to the right of small shareholder director, right to appoint small shareholder director. Now, the next right is right to apply to, right to apply to NCLT for operation and mismanagement. Right to apply to NCLT for operation, not operation, it is operation. Operation means when we are oppressing someone, when we are depriving someone, when we are pressurizing someone, and mismanagement. NCLT is National Company Law Tribunal. So right to apply to National Company Law Tribunal for oppression and for mismanagement. Now here, minority shareholders are also provided the right to approach to the National Company Law Tribunal to report any acts of oppression and mismanagement by the board of directors or the management of the company. For applying to the NCLT for any mismanagement or for any oppression, there is a condition, and the condition says that the number of shareholders should be at least 100 or 1/10 of the total number of shareholder, whichever is less. When the small shareholder wants to approach the NCLT to report any type of mismanagement or any type of operation, then the condition is that individually the small shareholder cannot approach the NCLT, but the condition is that at least 100 shareholders should come together, or 10%, 1/10 of the small shareholders should come in a group and they should approach the NCLT to report any type of mismanagement or operation being done in the company. So that is the right to apply for operation and mismanagement. Now here it is also explained that what comes under operation and what comes under mismanagement. Now, oppression means exercising power or authority in unjust manner. When the board of director or the management of the company is exercising their authority in a unjust manner, that means in a unfair manner, then it can be called as oppression. Now, when we can, they have given the examples also. For example, not calling a general board meeting. When the company or the board of directors of the company is not calling the annual general meeting, then it will come under oppression. Or when they are depriving the members of right to dividend. Company has made profit, but as the shareholders are minority shareholders, they doesn't have that many rights as compared to the majority shareholders. They are deprived of dividend facility. If such is the case, then yes, it will also come under the term oppression. Now, the second term under the right to apply to NCLT for operation and mismanagement is mismanagement. The term mismanagement means conducting the affairs of the company in a manner which is against the public interest or against the interest of the company. So those practices will be covered under the term mismanagement. Examples of mismanagement is also listed. Now, those examples which can be included for mismanagement are making personal profit out of company's business. If the top official of the company or any board of director of the company or the entire board of the company is making personal profit out of company's business, that will be termed as mismanagement done by the company. Second example given for mismanagement is directors continuing to draw their salaries while the company is posting losses continuously. For 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, if company is posting losses, is company's business is into losses, and still the directors are drawing their complete salary, their complete package, then that particular thing will again be covered under mismanagement. The third example of mismanagement is misusing the management control of the company. Under that, misusing the management control over the company is that if they are doing some unfair practices when they are controlling the management of the company, that will be termed as mismanagement. Suppose the chairperson of the board of director wants his relative to be appointed as a manager. Although the relative doesn't have the required qualification, but as he is holding the topmost position of the company, because of his position, he is influencing the appointment in the company. If he is doing such thing, then this action will be termed under the term mismanagement. Now the next example given for mismanagement is violating any of the law or statute of the company. If the board of director or if the company is violating the laws of the Companies Act or any law which is framed by SEBI or any law which is framed by the controlling machinery of appointed by the government, then that particular thing will be called as mismanagement. Or if the company has framed memorandum of association, company has its article of association, and if the management of the company or board of the company is not following that or is going against those articles of association or memorandum of association, then it will be termed as mismanagement. So these are some of the examples for operation, and these are some of the examples of mismanagement too. So they have given that when the small shareholders can approach and how they can approach NCLT, that is National Company Law Tribunal. Now here, if the National Company Law Tribunal finds that the company affairs are conducted in an oppressive manner or are mismanaged, then they can pass an order or they can pass certain regulations. The regulations or orders what can be passed by the NCLT, that we will be discussing. They have listed 5 orders which can be passed. First order which can be passed if the NCLT if they know or if they are satisfied that yes, some oppressive measures are being implemented in the company or the company is doing some mismanagement, then certain orders can be passed. What orders can be passed, that we will be discussing. First order that can be passed by NCLT is regulation of conduct of the affairs of the company in future. If the NCLT comes to know about certain mismanagement or certain oppressive practices, then in future, how the company should conduct the company affairs, the guidelines can be framed by the NCLT, and these guidelines can be shared or can be given to that particular company, and those guidelines for that particular company will be called as order of the NCLT. So in future, how the company affairs are to be handled by that particular company, they are to be handled only on the basis of the guidelines which are or the order of the NCLT. Next is the NCLT can restrict on the transfer or allotment of shares of the company. If they come to know that there is certain mismanagement in the allotment or transfer of shares, some irregularity is taking place at that particular time, they can prohibit, they can restrict, they can stop the company from transfer or allotting the shares to the shareholders. Next order which can be passed by the NCLT is removal of managing director, manager, or any of the directors of the company. Now here, they are also being authorized under law. The tribunal is very powerful because it is a government authority, a government machinery appointed under the Companies Act. So they are having the authority, they are having the power to remove managing director, manager, or directors of the company. So this removal will take place only when it is proved that the company is into some oppressive measures, or they are doing some oppressive or mismanagement things are taking place in the company. So the person, if he is the managing director who is responsible for these practices, or if he is a manager, or even if he is a director of the company, that person can be removed by the tribunal. Next is imposition of next order which can be passed against the company is imposition of cost as may deem fit. The company or the board of director or the person who is involved in mismanagement or oppression, once it is proved, that person can be fined, that person can be monetary penalized by the NCLT. So these are certain orders which can be passed, which can become compulsory for the company to follow of the NCLT. These are the orders which are passed. The sole objective of these orders is to take care of the interest of the small shareholders. So that was related to right to apply to NCLT for operation and mismanagement. Now the next right is called as right to file a class action suit. I think only 2 minutes are remaining, so we will not be able to complete that. So we will take up another small right. Yes, one small right we will take up for discussion, and it will take hardly 2 or 3 minutes to complete it. And that is called as e-voting process. E-voting, we all know what e-voting is. It is electronic form of voting. Earlier, it was expected that a person should attend the general board meeting of the company in person if he or she wants to vote, exercise his or her voting right. But now, the things have changed. In the act itself, in the Companies Act, there is a provision of e-voting. Now this e-voting has become one of the right of the minority shareholder, because if it is not possible for the minority shareholder, as the company's registered office or corporate office, we will assume it is there in Mumbai, and the person, the small shareholder, is staying in Kanyakumari. So if it is not possible for the small shareholder to come all the way from Kanyakumari to Mumbai to attend the annual general board meeting of the company to become eligible for voting process. Here he can exercise his e-voting process. He can attend the meeting online, as well as he can do the voting. He can participate in the voting process through electronic source. Electronically, he can share his vote, and that vote is having the same value as it is given to the physical vote. So that is e-voting process. This e-voting process saves the shareholder. It is one of the right given to the shareholder, that even if the shareholder is a very small shareholder, even if the shareholder is very far from the corporate office of the company, still he can be part of that general board meeting with the help of this right, which is called as e-voting process. Now the next right. So another right which we will be taking up for discussion is related to right to file class action suit, that we will be discussing tomorrow, as well as we will be discussing the right for reconstruction and amalgamation of companies. These two rights we will be discussing, and if time permits tomorrow, we will be discussing a case also. So I request every one of you, please read the case related to Tata Group of Companies, or Tata Sons and Cyrus Smith.